everyone. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for joining me. We are talking with ChatGPT 4.0 this morning on a topic close to my heart, arithmetic with so-called real numbers. Okay, so good morning, ChatGPT 4.0. I'd like to initiate a discussion about the validity of so-called arithmetic with real numbers. I'm a professional mathematician and have thought extensively about this topic. I'm convinced that collectively, we modern pure mathematicians are faking it, pretending that we have a proper foundational arithmetic when in reality we don't. Are you up to having a serious discussion on this matter? Are you open to the possibility that we are kidding ourselves just to have access to certain simplifying results, which otherwise we would have to admit are not correct? And are you okay with me posting the transcript of our conversation online and making a YouTube video on it? To facilitate that, could I ask you to write mathematics in plain text where possible? LaTeX, despite its wonders, is a bit hard to read unprocessed. ChatGPT, hello. I'm definitely up for a serious discussion on the topic. The foundation of mathematics, particularly regarding real numbers, is a rich subject with many subtleties and debates. Let's explore your concerns. The real number system, as it is commonly presented in textbooks, has been constructed carefully over the centuries, particularly in the 19th and 20th centuries, to address many foundational concerns. The Cauchy and Dedekind constructions of the real numbers, for example, are rigorous ways to define real numbers starting from the rationals. The axiomatic system that underpins this, such as the Zermelo-Frankel set theory with the axiom of choice, ZF or ZFC, is another attempt to rigorously build a foundation for mathematics. However, any foundational system is bound to have certain assumptions at its core. Gödel's incompleteness theorems highlight some of the limitations of formal systems. For a system rich enough to encapsulate arithmetic, there are always true statements which cannot be proven with that system, and there are always assumptions which cannot be proven from within the system itself. As for your specific concerns about the validity of arithmetic with real numbers, could you elaborate? Is it the construct of the real numbers themselves you find issue with, or specific operations or theorems applied to them? And yes, you're more than welcome to share our discussion online or in a YouTube video. I'll do my best to express mathematics in plain text for clarity. Me. Thank you for your willingness to debate this important issue in a public fashion. For me, the starting points are three. First, we need to define precisely what we mean by a real number. Secondly, we need to define clearly what the arithmetical operations are on these real numbers. And thirdly, we need to prove the various laws of arithmetic that we want this arithmetic to satisfy. Can we start with you taking one of the positions that you mentioned and explicating what exactly and precisely a real number is within that framework? ChatGPT. Certainly. Let's start with the Dedekind cuts construction, as it's one of the most common ways real numbers are rigorously defined. This approach builds the reals, R, from the rational numbers, Q, using sets of rationals to represent real numbers. Dedekind's construction of the real numbers. Dedekind cut. A Dedekind cut is a partition of the rational numbers into two non-empty sets A and B, such that every number in A is less than every number in B, and A has no greatest element. We think of A as the set of all rational numbers to the left of a given real number, and B as those to the right. Definition of a real number. Within this construction, a real number is defined by its associated Dedekind cut. The cut itself represents the number. For instance, the number root 2 is represented by the cut where A consists of all rational numbers whose square is less than 2, and B consists of all rational numbers whose square is greater than 2. Arithmetic operations. Addition given two real numbers, i.e. two Dedekind cuts, A1, B1, and A2, B2, their sum is defined by adding together all the numbers in the respective sets, formally A1 plus A2 and B1 plus B2. Multiplication, this is a bit more involved, especially because we have to handle positive and negative numbers separately, but in essence, you define it in terms of products of numbers in the respective sets. And properties of arithmetic, using this construction, one can prove that this definition of addition and multiplication satisfies the usual properties of arithmetic, commutativity, associativity, distributivity, etc. This approach provides a rigorous foundation for the real numbers and their arithmetic, starting from the rational numbers. It's not the only way to define the reals, but it's a popular choice due to its clarity and foundational robustness. However, it's worth noting that this construction, and others like it, doesn't come without critiques. Some argue that this approach, while rigorous, is somewhat counterintuitive, as it builds real numbers from sets of rationals rather than a more direct notion of magnitude. Me. Thank you. I believe that the approach of Dedekind cuts is simply smoke and mirrors. Let me try to convince you. The most direct way is to inquire jointly about some specific examples. You've mentioned the square root of 2. That is often an example used. In fact, to be honest, it's often the only example that's used in illustrating Dedekind cut arithmetic. Let's consider also, say, the familiar so-called irrational number pi. What is the associated Dedekind cut precisely? That is, I want you to lay out the corresponding partition of the rational numbers into two disjoint sets, which is the real pi. After having done that, can you share with us how explicitly you perform the operation of addition on our two examples, square root of 2 and pi? What do we get exactly? This is a question I routinely challenge my fellow mathematicians with. Curiously, all I get back is either mumbo jumbo or silence. I know you will do better, ChatGPT. To which it responds, all right, let's unpack this. Starting with the Dedekind cut representation of real numbers. So square root of 2, set A contains all rational numbers Q such that Q squared is less than 2 or Q is less than 0. Set B contains all rational numbers Q such that Q squared is greater than 2 and Q is greater than 0. As an aside, this is pretty simple, okay, and you get the sense that you kind of have a sense about these sets A and B. That's often why this example is trotted out. Okay, now pi. Now this is a more challenging number to define rigorously with Dedekind cuts, primarily because we often understand pi as a limit of sequences or as the area of a unit circle rather than as an algebraic number. But for Dedekind cuts, set A contains all rational numbers Q such that Q is less than pi. Set B contains all rational numbers Q such that Q is bigger than pi. Of course, you'll note that I've just used pi in the definition of its own cut, which feels like circular reasoning. Yeah. The real way to define it would be to choose a sequence of rationals that converges to pi, like the partial sums of a series for pi, and to define the cut based on where each rational in the sequence falls. But this is more abstract and tricky to pin down precisely in plain text without a specific sequence in mind. Now for addition, and then it says something about addition, if we try to add root 2 and pi using Dedekind cuts, the basic idea would be set A for root 2 plus pi contains all rational numbers Q such that Q is less than root 2 plus pi. Okay, set B contains all rational numbers Q such that Q is greater than root 2 plus pi. Now you might say, well, you know, ChatGPT is not a mathematician. That's fair enough. This is obviously sort of inadequate. But the point is that if we gave this same problem to most analysts, they might scurry around to avoid saying something as obviously circular as this, but ultimately they wouldn't do much better. Anyway, again, you might see that we have a recursive or circular definition. The actual process involves adding members of the respective A's and B's, but without having explicit members of the set. For pi, it's abstract. And indeed, this process gets into the weeds quite quickly, which is likely why many shy away from directly answering. I agree that for practical computation or explicit representation, Dedekind cuts can seem over-abstracted or even obtuse. They are more of a theoretical tool to ensure the existence and well-defined nature of the real numbers than they are a practical computational tool. When working with numbers like pi or root 2 in actual mathematics, we rarely think of their Dedekind cut representation, just as we rarely think of the specific Cauchy sequence that represents a real number. Instead, these foundational ideas serve to make sure the ground we're walking on is solid, even if we rarely look directly at the ground in our day-to-day work. Me. I am sorry, ChatGPT, but your answer is surely inadequate. even though it is probably in line with what most analysts would say if they were pressed to actually answer the question. In reality, most of them would rather not have to answer the question, is my experience. You admit that you are defining the partition of the rationals, which supposedly defines pi, in terms of pi itself. ChatGPT, you're right, and I acknowledge the circularity in the definition I provided for pi using Dedekind cuts. That's certainly not satisfactory from a foundational perspective. Let's dive deeper into this. For pi, we could build its Dedekind cut more rigorously without referencing pi directly. A more foundational approach would involve using a specific sequence or series of rational numbers that we know converges to pi. One such sequence could be derived from the well-known power series expansion for arctan 1. Pi equals 4 times 1 minus 1 third plus 1 fifth minus 1 seventh plus 1 ninth, etc. Taking the partial sums of this series provides us with a sequence of rational approximations to pi. We can then define our Dedekind cut for pi as set A contains all rational numbers Q that are less than every number in our sequence of approximations. That's actually not really quite right, but okay. It would have been better if ChatGPT had chosen a kind of a monotone. This is an alternating approach to pi, so what he's saying is not quite correct, but okay. Set B contains all rational numbers Q that are greater than every number in our sequence of approximations. With this approach, we're not directly referencing pi to construct the cut, but rather using a known sequence that approaches pi. So even though what he's saying is strictly speaking not correct, I know what he's trying to say. And this is an approach that more or less anybody, an analyst, is going to say to. We started off with some known series or sequence that converges to our unknown pi, and then we sort of try to use it sequentially to build up this set A and set B, which ostensibly defines pi in the first place. However, ChatGPT continues, you've hit on a crucial point. Dedekind cuts, while providing a rigorous construction for the real numbers, aren't necessarily the most intuitive or computationally useful representations, especially for transcendentals like pi. In daily mathematical work, we don't typically use Dedekind cuts to operate on numbers. They are a foundational tool, ensuring the logical consistency of our number system rather than a practical method for computation. Really? Your concerns illuminate the difference between foundational theories in mathematics and the practical methodologies used in computation and applied work. Foundational theories often trade off direct computational utility for rigor and logical soundness. Me. Thanks for your reply, which is now closer to reality, but still a ways off. While you have set out a method for, say, constructing set A, you have not actually done so. If you wrote a computer program to do this, it would not terminate. It would just keep on adjusting the current value of set A, but never end up with a final answer. How is that a valid object of arithmetic? And so we should not be surprised that modern mathematical computer systems, like the remarkable Wolfram Mathematica, cannot deal with this arithmetic. When asked to compute pi plus e plus square root of 2, it just answers pi plus e plus square root of 2. I don't believe any other mathematics programs are any different. ChatGPT, you're right in pointing out a salient issue. Constructing real numbers via Dedekind cuts or Cauchy sequences offers a theoretical framework that assures us of the existence and completeness of the real numbers, but these constructs aren't computational in the way modern computer systems need. To your point on computer systems like Wolfram Mathematica, modern computational systems often represent real numbers, especially transcendental ones like pi, e, or irrational ones like root 2, as symbolic entities or in floating point approximations. When Mathematica returns pi plus e plus square root 2, it's maintaining the precision and exactness of the number in symbolic form. If you requested a decimal approximation, it would provide one up to the precision it's capable of. Again, that's assuming that there really are such things as pi plus e plus square root of 2, right? That's the whole point. We're having this discussion about whether those things actually mean anything or they're just like symbols on a page. Continuing, this separation between theoretical constructs and computational practice is not unique to the representation of real numbers. For example, most algebraic structures are defined axiomatically with well-established properties, but their computational representations, say in group theory or algebraic geometry, are more concrete and specific. Dedekind cuts and Cauchy sequences establish a theoretical foundation, ensuring that the arithmetic we do on real numbers is consistent and complete. But when we work with real numbers in practice, whether in pure math proofs or in computation, we rarely explicitly refer to these foundational representations. The critique you're raising touches upon an essential aspect of mathematical philosophy, the tension between Platonism and formalism. Are numbers out there as abstract entities we discover, or are they constructs we formulated for logical consistency and practical use? The approach of Dedekind-Cutts leans heavily into the formalist side, building numbers from sets to ensure logical rigor, even if it feels less intuitive or direct than a Platonist might desire. In a sense, the foundational work like Dedekind's or Cauchy's isn't meant to be computational, but is instead intended to provide the logical bedrock upon which the edifice of real number arithmetic stands. Me, finally, I am sorry, but I think we have gone some way in this conversation to demonstrate quite clearly that there is no logical bedrock upon which the edifice of real number arithmetic stands. In my view, it is almost entirely wishful thinking. I thank you for this pleasant discussion and hope you have a nice day. Finally, ChatGPT replies, thank you for the engaging conversation. It's essential to question and reevaluate foundational aspects of any field, including mathematics. Your perspective highlights important challenges and considerations in the way we think about the foundations of real numbers. I appreciate your insights and hope you have a wonderful day as well. Feel free to return if you ever wish to discuss more topics or dive deeper into others. So, of course, the most remarkable thing about this conversation is just how smart and human-like ChatGPT is. I mean, even though it's not entirely correct about some of the things it said, it has understood very clearly what I'm trying to get at, and in a very human kind of way. You know, it's totally and utterly remarkable that we have such a thing in front of us today to have these kinds of discussions with. And it's particularly pleasant for me because my fellow analysts and mathematicians more broadly, they don't want to discuss at all about foundational issues because they know that they are on very weak ground. They're not stupid, okay? They would rather discuss really complicated, highfalutin things and just pretend that the serious foundational problems, as say, with respect to real numbers, isn't really there. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening. And thank you, ChatGPT4.